Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Welcome, dear students. Myself, Dr. Ajay Semelty from Department of Pharmaceutical Sciences, HNB Gadwal University, the Central University, Srinagar Gadwal, Uttarakhand. Welcome. In our series of lectures on pharmaceutical production technologies, today we are here with another lecture on parenteral dosage form and parenteral production technologies. And today we are going to discuss the evaluation of parenteral dosage form, pyrogens, endotoxins, their eliminations, and quality control test. So let's enjoy this lecture. After going through this lecture, you will be able to learn about the evaluation of parenterals. You learn what are the pyrogens, what are the endotoxins, what are their bioactivities, how they can be eliminated, what are their source, and all the evaluation parameters of the parenteral dosage forms or sterile products. As far as the lesson plan is concerned, we'll be covering this lecture under the topics introduction of pyrogen and importance, their endotoxin, their classification, their structure, sources of pyrogen contaminations. Then we'll be covering the how we can eliminate the pyrogens. Then thereafter we'll be moving to the quality control test or the evaluation of parenteral products or sterile products. So let's start our discussion on parenteral evaluation. Pyrogens, these are the metabolic products of microorganisms, and parenteral products or all sterile products, they must be pyrogen free. You must remember this thing. There must not be any pyrogen in any sterile product. Parenteral administration of pyrogen may cause fever, increase in the body temperature, obviously, reduction of the blood pressure, thrombosis, hemorrhages of the skin and the mucous membrane, shock, tissue damage, inflammation, sepsis, or even the death. As far as the endotoxin is concerned, they are also associated with the various harmful effects. What are endotoxins? Endotoxins are also called as lipopolysaccharides. These are chemically they are lipopolysaccharides and are complex of pyrogenic lipopolysaccharide, and in nature they are protein, they are inert lipid, they are constituted with the help of protein and inert lipids. Based on the behavior of their gram staining, we call, or the bacteria, based on the behavior of the bacteria, again the different staining methods, that is called gram staining. On the basis of gram staining, they can be grouped either as gram negative bacteria or the gram positive bacteria. You know it very well in the plus two standard. Even we have studied about this gram staining. Now, what are the gram positive bacteria? The gram positive bacteria are having the thick mesh like cell wall consisting mainly of peptidoglycan that surrounds the cytoplasmic membrane. The peptidoglycan layer, also called murine, it serves as an exoskeleton and It consists of teichoic and lipoteichoic acids. What are the examples of gram-positive bacteria? Streptococcus pyxis, which cause the pneumonia. Bacillus anthracis, which cause the anthrax. Clostridium species, like botulism and tetanus causing bacteria there. So these are the gram-positive bacteria. Now let's see what is the composition of their cell wall. As we have mentioned that they are having a thick cell wall. The cell wall is made up of phospholipids and peptidoglycans, and this contains teichoic acid and lipoteichoic acid, which we have mentioned. And they are having the peptides in this layer, as we can see here. So it is a thick cell wall, which we can see, and it is a characteristic of gram-positive bacteria. Gram-negative bacteria. The cell wall here is more complex. The peptidoglycan layer is much thinner here, and an outer membrane may also be found on its external surface. Basically, they are non-symmetric double phospholipid layer they are having, and their outer level is formed by lipopolysaccharides and proteins. Examples include Vibrio cholera, Salmonella typhi, Cesiella species, and E. coli, Escherichia coli, which is the member of our normal human intestine flora. Now let's see the cell wall of gram-negative bacteria. So what we have discussed, that it is having thinner one, but it is quite complex as compared to the gram-positive bacteria. It is comprising of lipopolysaccharides and lipoproteins. Peptidoglycan layer is quite thinner here, as you can see here. Okay, and the phospholipids are also there. So phospholipid, lipoproteins, peptidoglycan, and peptidoglycan layer is little bit thinner. Okay. Now let's discuss endotoxin. Endotoxins are lipopolysaccharides or LPS. They are heat stable, resistant to proteolytic enzymes, immunogenic they are. They cannot be converted to toxoids. These are the toxins which cannot be converted into toxoids, and they are produced by the gram-negative bacteria. Yes, so endotoxins cannot be converted into toxoids. Okay, like tetanus toxoids. Tetanus is also a toxin, but it can be converted into toxoid. So tetanus toxoid is used as a vaccine. So this they exist in high molecular weight aggregate forms. However, the monomer units of LPS, the lipopolysaccharides, is less than 10,000 daltons, enabling endotoxin to easily pass through, and they are sterilizing by the 0.2 micron filters. The lipopolysaccharides can be divided into three distinct regions: the lipid A, the R core, and the O specific chain. The lipid A part is responsible for the toxic biological effect. It has hydrophobic structure directed towards the interior of the cell wall, and it has got the specific glycophospholipid, usually a phosphorylated disaccharide, a base phosphorylated disaccharide backbone, acylated with fatty acid chains. The R core is an oligosaccharide and can be divided into two subunits, inner core and outer core. The inner core has the same composition in all gram-negative bacteria, containing rarely occurring components, haptose and 3-deoxy D-mano 2-octalonic acid, KDO it is abbreviated as, and is linked to the lipid A part. The outer core is made up to 6 hexose components and is linked to the O specific side chain. The outermost elements of the LPS structure is the hydrophilic O-specific chain, which is built up from 1 to 40 repeating units of 2 to 7 sugar components. So this was about the structure of endotoxin. As far as the bioactivity of endotoxin is concerned, it shows immune response after releasing from the surface of the bacteria. As lipopolysaccharides releases, it binds to the lipopolysaccharide binding proteins LBP, and this complex is transferred to CD14 on the surface of monocytes and macrophages and to receptor 4 TLR4 on the surface of macrophages and endothelial cells. These are then activated macrophages induce the production of cytokines like interleukin-1, interleukin-6, interleukin-8, TNF, tissue necrosis factor, alpha and IFN, gamma, etc. So prostaglandins and leukotrien, which are powerful inflammation and septic shock causing mediators, these are required for the adaptive immune response. The release of large amount of endotoxins into the blood stream induces endotoxemia, causing a wide variety of symptoms such as chills, fever, septic shock, circulatory failure, and even the death. What are the characteristics of endotoxin shock? Hypotension, disturbances of organic functions, metabolic acidosis, thrombocytolysis, and disseminated intravascular coagulation, that is called DIC. During pregnancy, this increased secretion of opioid peptides may cause the decidual hemorrhage, premature birth, or even the abortion. So, endotoxin bioactivity is not at all, in any case, it is not having any positive effect. All the harmful effects are associated with the endotoxins. Now let's see what are the source of pyrogen contamination. Solvents, which is the most important source, the medicament, even the API may have the pyrogens. When the raw material is there in the storage condition before the use, so it may be contaminated with the pyrogen. The apparatus with the in process due to the, you know, in contact with the personnel there due to some other environmental exposure, the apparatus may also have the pyrogens. And the method of storage between the preparation and sterilization, okay, or even in the before the raw material stored, this raw material in the storage condition may get the source of may get the pyrogen, and they may act as a source of pyrogen. Now let us discuss the pyrogen elimination methods. How we can eliminate the pyrogens? First is absorption. We can absorb them on the surface of selective adsorbents. The second method may be solvent extraction. Pyrogen can be destroyed by heating at high temperature, which we generally do boiling water, okay, at the time of diarrhea and other things. Well, the first thing is to eliminate the pyrogen, so we just boil the water. So heating is one of the most important and most common form of pyrogen elimination method. We heat the solvent by to 250 degrees Celsius for 45 minutes, or the exposure of 650 degrees Celsius for 1 minute, or 180 degrees Celsius for 4 hours. Likewise, we can destroy with the different set of temperature and time conditions. We can destroy the pyrogen depending upon the material to which we are performing this in an elimination method. Okay, because the API or the material may be thermolabile, it may be sensitive to heat, so we should select a temperature and time condition on the basis of nature of the material from which we are removing the pyrogen. Then selective extraction procedures, and then careful heating with dilute alkali, dilute acid or mild oxidizing agent. Then there comes another method, ultrafiltration. It is also sometimes used to eliminate the pyrogens. How we can control the pyrogens? Now the question comes, how we can control the pyrogens? It is very difficult to eliminate the pyrogens from contaminated injections. Certain percutaneous, some precautions you can take to control the pyrogens contamination throughout the entire process of production manufacturing. Therefore, the compounding and manufacturing process should be carried out expeditiously, as early as possible, rapidly as possible, preferably planning completion of the process, including sterilization, within the maximum allowed time according to the process validation studies. So time must be taken care of, okay, to control the pyrogens. The manufacturing process must be carried out with great care and as rapidly as possible to minimize the risk of microbial contamination. Preferably, no more product should be prepared that can be processed completely within one working day, including the sterilization. So including the sterilization should be done immediately after the processing and in one single slot, the processing and sterilization should be done. Okay, we cannot leave sterilization for next day. It should be done immediately after the preparation. Now, when we have discussed the control of pyrogens, now it's the time to discuss. It is the time to discuss the evaluation of parenterals. How we can evaluate the parenterals? What are the quality control tests? Test for pyrogens. It may be done with the help of rabbit test or bacterial endotoxin test. Particulate evaluation test. The second one, leakage test, and then sterility test. So these are the four major evaluation parameters, evaluation tests, which are conducted for parenteral or the sterile products. Now first take that rabbit test, sham test. That is first we perform the sham test, preliminary test it is called. IV injection of sterile pyrogen-free saline solution, just saline solution, is given to the animal to exclude any animal showing an unusual response to the trauma, shock of injection. Any animal showing a temperature variation greater than 0.6 degrees Celsius is not used in the mains test. So this is the preliminary test. Verbatim you should learn that there must not be a difference of 0.6 degrees Celsius, temperature variation must not be there when we have injected a saline solution, pyrogen free saline solution. So it is the basis of selecting the animals for the main test. The preliminary test govern, finalize the animals for the main test. So what is the main test? In the main test, you take the group of three rabbits. Preparation and injection of the product you perform by warming the product, dissolving or dilution, and then duration of injection should not be more than 4 minutes. The injected volume should be not less than 0.5 ml per kilogram and not more than 10 ml per kilogram of body mass of the animal. Now, the determination of the initial and maximum temperature is done. You just record the initial temperature, body temperature, and the maximum temperature after the injection. So all rabbits should have the initial temperature from 38 to 39.8 degrees Celsius. And the difference of the initial temperature should not differ from one another by more than 1 degree Celsius. Remember this thing. Now, how we can interpret the results? The test is carried out on the first group of three rabbits. If necessary, on further group of three rabbits to a total of four groups depending on the results obtained. Intervals of passing or failing of products area on the basis of some temperature response is done. How? Let's see. In this table you can see the number of rabbits, individual temperature rise in group, in degree Celsius, and that whether the test passes or not. If three rabbits you have taken, and the individual temperature rise is 0.6 degree, and the temperature rise in the entire group is maximum 1.4, then it passes this rabbit test. If in this phase, in the above test, if it is not passed, then you take 5 more rabbits. So total 8 rabbits we are having. The individual temperature rise must not be greater than 0.6, and temperature rise in the group must not be more than 3.7. Total group, total temperature rise must not be more than 3.7. You will sum up all the temperature rise, and the temperature rise must not be greater than the 3.7. It is a ceiling, and then the test passes. So if above test is not passed, the sample is said to be pyrogenic, or go through the source of contamination of pyrogen and try to remove the pyrogen source. Okay. Now moving to bacterial endotoxin. To detect or quantify the endotoxin or gram-negative bacteria origin, we do this test, BET, bacterial endotoxin test. Amoebocyte lysate from horseshoe crab is used here, Limulus polyphemus or Tachyphilus tridentus. The name of the test is also Limulus amoebocyte lysate or LAL test. We call it LAL test commonly. So Limulus polyphemus is the horseshoe crab from where we obtain the source. How we do this LAL test? The test is based on the primitive blood clotting mechanism of the horseshoe crab enzyme located with the crab's amoebocyte. So we take this enzyme from the horseshoe crab, this crab's amoebocyte. The blood cells with endotoxin, they initiate enzymatic coagulation cascade, and they form the proteinase gel. So if gel is formed, it means the endotoxins are there. Simple. You must have this principle in your brain, in your mind, that yes, yeah, if endotoxin are present, the gel will be formed when it is there. Okay. So in brief, we can say that we must avoid the endotoxin contamination, and before the test it should be avoided, and interfering factors should not be present there. Equipment should be depyrogenated, and the sensitivity of the lysate should be known. Okay, lysate sensitivity you must know. What we do here, the LAL reagent is taken and test solution equal in the equal volume. Usually 0.1 ml of each is taken and mixed in a depyrogenated test tube, incubated to the 37 degrees Celsius to 1 hour, up to 1 hour. Remove the tube, invert in one smooth motion, 180 degree. Read the result, observe the result, whether it passes or fail. There are three different techniques: the gel clot technique, that is gel formation; the turbidimetry technique, the development of turbidity after the cleavage of endogenous substance is observed in this method; and the chromatogenic technique, the development of color after the cleavage of a synthetic peptide chromogen complex is observed in this test. So the LAL test can be identified with the help of gel clot technique, turbidimetric, or chromogenic. There are three techniques by which the LAL test can be performed. So there are six other methods with different steps of accuracy of LAL test. Method A, B, C, D, E, and F. Method A is a gel clot method. Method is a gel clot method. It's a limit test. Method B is a gel clot method, or it is a semi-quantity test. Method C is a turbidimetric method and turbidimetric kinetic method. Method D is chromogenic kinetic method. Method E is again chromogenic, but endpoint method it is. By method F is turbidimetric endpoint method. In the event of doubt or dispute, the final decision is made upon method A, unless otherwise indicated in the monograph. So method A is the decisive method. Now let us see the result. That in the method A, gel clot method, in the limit, what is the which is having the limit test, a firm gel positive result provides the positive result. An intact gel is not, if intact gel is not formed, then the result is negative. In the method B, which is a gel clot method and semi-quantitative test or titrimetric method, the results are expressed at concentration of endotoxin as less quality or greater than the labeled lysate sensitivity. Okay. The method C, the turbidimetry kinetic method. In this method, the onset time needed for the reaction mixture to reach a predetermined absorbance or the rate of turbidity development is observed. While the method D, which is a chromogenic kinetic method, the onset time needed for the reaction mixture to reach a predetermined absorbance or the rate of color development is observed. While the method E, the chromogenic endpoint method, the quantity relationship between the endotoxin concentration and the quantity of chromophore released at the end of an incubation method, incubation period, is observed. In the method F, turbidimetric endpoint method. Remember this, the name method. You just can't write method A, B, C, D, E, F. You also should refer that what is this method. Quantity relationship in method F, that is turbidimetry endpoint method, the quantity relationship between the endotoxin concentration and the turbidity absorbance or transmission of the reaction mixture at the end of an incubation period is observed. Now moving to, now we have determined the pyrogen test we have done, okay, that is with the rabbit test, sham test, bacterial endotoxin test, Lal test, okay, you can say, and then we move to the, we are moving to the particulate evaluation. The entire product should be inspected by human inspectors under good light, baffled against reflection into the eyes and against black and white background. Any container with visible particle if seen is discarded. However, these methods are also automated nowadays with the help of laser and other automated techniques, that the advanced techniques are also available. You can also employ these techniques for evaluating the particulate in the sterile products. So what is the limitation that in the manual one, the size of the particles that can be seen by the visible, which is visible by the naked eyes, are 50 microns. Only the 50 micron particle can be observed. Variation of visual acuity from inspector to inspector may be there. Emotional stress may have the different result. Eye strains, fatigue. So with manual, there are with the manual observation, these are some limitations. For particulate evaluation, stage 1 light obscuration is referred as stage 1, and then stage 2 microscopic particulate count is done. In light obscuration method, equipment used to count and measure the size of particles by means of a shadow cast by the particle as it passes through a high intensity light beam. Okay, so the light obscuration method, but if it is simply, if it is making a shadow, because the light is coming and if particle is there, a shadow will be formed, so it will be automatically detected. Okay, in the BP, Japanese pharmacopoeia, British pharmacopoeia, Japanese pharmacopoeia, United States pharmacopoeia, the particulate matter limits are determined by, for the light obscuration test, these are the limits. So what are the LOPC? In the LOPC test, if nominal values are for more than 100 ml sterile product, for the nominal values less than is greater than or 10 micron, while greater than 25 micron. In case of more than 100 ml, the 25 particles per ml, while for in second case 3 particles per ml. If 100 ml or less, the value is volume is 100 ml or less, less than 100 ml, there 6000 particles per container. In the particles of 10 microns should be greater than or equal to, maybe they can, the limit is 6000 particles per container, while for 25 micron particles the limit is 600 particles per container. Okay, so this is the limit you must learn. For more than 100 ml, the limit is 25 particles per ml. The limit for 10 micron particle are 25 particles per ml. For 25 micron and more, 3 particles per ml is the limit. Okay, so by this way you must have an idea about the LOPC limits by the BP, JP and USPs. Microscopic method, sample, in this method the sample is filtered through the membrane filter under the ultra clean condition, and counting the particle is done on the surface of a filter. If limit exceeds for stage 1, the sample is subjected to stage 2. The BP, JP and USP limits to for particulate matters is determined by the MPC test. For nominal values, again for particles of greater than 10 micron and for particles greater than 25 micron, for nominal values more than 100 ml, the limit is 12 particles per 100 ml per ml, and for 2 particles per ml for more than 25 microns. In the case of 100 ml or less than 100 ml, it is 3000 particles per container for 10 micron or more than 10 micron particles. For 25 micron for 25 micron particles, it should be 300 particles per container. So this is the limit for the which is prescribed by the BP, JP and USP. Now after the particulate test, we have covered the pyrogen testing, then particulate testing. Now it is a time to discuss the Leaker test. Ampoules heated by the fusion are subjected for the Leaker test. The negative pressure is built within an incompletely sealed ampoule, submerged entirely into the deeply colored solution like methylene blue solution, and all leakers are discarded. Please remember that vials and bottles are not subjected to Leaker test because the sealing material is not rigid in these cases. So friends, these are some of the further readings I recommend for you if you want to go into the detail of the parentals. They are one of the some of the specifically chosen references for you. Now let me summarize this lecture for you. What are the pyrogens? What are the endotoxins? Pyrogens are lipopolysaccharides. These, whether you take the pyrogen or endotoxin, they are associated with the various harmful effects when injected into the bloodstream. They may cause fever, shock, hyper blood pressure. Okay, that various other harmful effects, even the death. Endotoxin induces the cascade of reactions mediated by the various mediators like interleukins and all that. We need to eliminate the pyrogen and endotoxins. So elimination of pyrogens can be done by the heating and various methods. Okay, we have discussed the ultrafiltration and all that in the methods. Please go into the detail about the elimination methods which we have discussed in this lecture, and then we discuss also the source of pyrogens. Maybe it may be there in the raw material, it may be there in API, it may be there in storage condition, it may be there in the processing during pressing apparatus, may be the source of pyrogens. So you must take care of the source and the entire, and we have already discussed the plant layout. In the plant layout, the what kind of class 100, class 1000, these the particulate matter and pyrogens, the sterility, the aseptic environment must be maintained in the entire production technologies, entire the production house of the parentals. As far as the quality control test for parental are concerned, there are the four major quality control tests we perform. Number one, the pyrogen, for pyrogen removal, pyrogen testing, that is rabbit test. Sham test is the primary test, then we go for the main test. Okay, the temperature variation must not be the temperature increase must not be greater than as prescribed by the pharmacopoeia. Then particulate analysis. Particulate analysis, we have discussed the different methods. Okay, and before particulate analysis, we discuss the Lal test. Okay, Lal test, for Lal test, that is, this is a bacterial endotoxin test, which is also called the gel formation indicates the presence of endotoxin. Then we move for the particulate test. The particulate analysis may be done by the visual method or by the other method, light obstruction method, and other automatic methods may be done. Then Leaker test, leaking must be checked with the help of negative pressure we perform, and then any leaker is excluded from the batch. As far as the sterility is concerned, sterility test is done by the various method, membrane filtration method and direct inoculation method, okay, direct transfer method or membrane filtration method. And these methods we are going to discuss in our next lecture, specifically all the sterility tests and the sterilization methods we are going to discuss in our next lecture. So stay tuned for our next lecture and please go through the further readings which we have recommended for you. Thank you for being with us. Happy learning.